to give thanks for all that he had. Abraham and Sarah, gotta love, gotta love. Great story. Everybody in here probably can tell me the story of Abraham and Sarah better than I can. But we're going to walk through this together. See maybe today if we find something that is a little bit different. Because Abraham and Sarah are a story we've all heard for a number of years. Chapter 22. Now it came to pass after these things that God tested Abraham and said to him, Abraham. And he said, here I am. Then he said, take now your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the land of Moriah and offer him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains of which I shall tell you. So Abraham rose very early in the morning and saddled his donkey and took two of his young men with him and Isaac his son. And he split the wood for the burnt offering and arose and went to the place of which God had told him. Then on the third day, Abraham lifted his eyes and saw the place afar off. And Abraham said to his young men, you stay here with the donkey. The lad and I will go yonder and worship, and we will come back to you. So Abraham took the wood of the burnt offering and laid it on Isaac, his son. And he took the fire in his hand and a knife, and the two of them went together. But Isaac spoke to Abraham, his father, and he said, my father. And he said, here I am, my son. And then he said, look, the fire and the wood. But where is the lamb for a burnt offering? And Abraham replied, my son, God will provide for himself the lamb for a burnt offering. So the two of them went together. Then they came to the place which God had told him. And Abraham built an altar there and placed the wood in order. And he bound Isaac his son and laid him on the altar upon the wood. And Abraham stretched out his hand and he took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called to him from heaven and said, Abraham, Abraham. And Abraham said, so here I am. And the Lord said, do not lay your hand on the lad or do anything to him. For now I know that you fear God, since you have not withheld your son, your only son, from me. Then Abraham lifted his eyes and looked, and there behind him was a ram caught in a thicket by its horns. So Abraham went and took the ram and offered it up for a burnt offering instead of his son. And Abraham called the name of the place, the Lord will provide, as it is called to this day, in the mount of the Lord it shall be provided. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. There was a minister who was trying to keep his wife happy. Ministers do that just like everybody else. And one spring day, he bought her a clematis, one of those vines that climbs. And she didn't know about it, and he was going to surprise her. Could have been maybe just before Mother's Day. It was a Mother's Day gift. So he was building a trellis to put in the pot so that the clematis would have something to climb up. And as he hammered away and worked on it, he felt somebody was watching him. And he knew there wasn't anybody in his backyard, but he just had that feeling that there were eyes on him. So he looked around, and there peering over the fence was the little boy that lived next door, very intently watching that minister as he built that trellis. Well, it kind of made the minister proud. He thought, this kid wants to learn something, and he thinks I'm the one that can teach him. So he kept on building that trellis for a minute, and finally he looked over at the little boy and he says, hey there, how are you today? And the young man says, I'm fine. He says, are you trying to pick up a few tips on gardening or on carpentry? And the little boy looked right at the preacher and he said, no, sir, I want to know what a preacher says when he hits his thumb with the hammer. So, you know, the minister's bubble was burst, and that's kind of a sticky situation, isn't it? And my question is, as I studied this, read that, how would I pass that test? My question to you is, how would you pass that test? And there are times in our lives that we don't even know we're being tested. But that's not the case in today's scripture, not in this passage that we're in. Listen again to those important words. Sometime later, God tested Abraham. Six very simple words, but they mean so much. And we're all familiar with Genesis. You know the story of Abraham and Sarah. And we've spent time over our lives studying what they went through. So here we find Abraham now at age 75 or 78 or 80, somewhere in there, this very wealthy, well-set, comfortable gentleman who leaves home in his nice cosmopolitan city that he lives in. He leaves his extended family, and he leaves all of his security in order to do what? In order to set out on this undefined journey that God has put forward forth to him to go to a distant land. He's set apart from all the people that he knew and his family, and he's set apart in order to do what? To create a new nation. And that nation is one that would be especially chosen by God. Now, God did promise to bless Abraham for his obedience. And Abraham was so obedient in so many things. But God made one promise that just seemed way too good to be true. And that promise was that in their advanced age, what was going to happen? Abraham and Sarah were going to have a child of their own. Now, do you remember what happened when Sarah heard that? What did Sarah do when she heard she was going to have a child of her own? She laughed. It was ludicrous. She laughed. And, you know, she heard the promise, she laughed. And think about what I would do or you would do. So then later on down the road, when they're about 90, that promise is fulfilled. And God tells Sarah what to name the child. She's supposed to name him Isaac. And you know what Isaac means? It means he laughs. Now, let's think about this in reality. Think about the joy. The pure, unmitigated joy that Abraham and Sarah, after all of these years, must have felt, knowing that they were finally going to have a child. And that they knew, after all this disappointment, God was going to bless them, because people at that time, just like people today, considered children a blessing from God. But that was the blessing that they had never received. So here we have this happen. Now let's go back and remember what Abraham has done and who he is, because Abraham has already committed his life to the Lord. So with that commitment in mind, he takes Isaac. And he has him serve. He circumcises his own son. And he consecrates Isaac to the Lord. And at that point, Abraham had to feel, I've done it all. I've given my son to God. I've given myself to God. Now comes the good stuff. Now I can kick back. I can take off my shoes. I can rock on the front porch, and I can watch that baby learn to be a young man. I can watch him learn to walk. I can pick him up when he falls down and has to get 2 stitches in his chin. I can be a daddy, even though I am old. I can enjoy this blessing. and I can reap all the blessings that God has intended for me. Well, that's not the way it happened. Because then comes this verse. Sometime later, God tested Abraham. So much for a life of leisure. So much for taking it easy. And God said to Abraham, take your son, your only son, Isaac, whom you love, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on one of the mountains that I will tell you about. Now, that's pretty straightforward. There's no room for compromise here. There's no room for wiggling here. There's no chance for Abraham misunderstanding what God is saying. And it's not like God doesn't get it and is ignorant of how much Abraham loves that son. You know, sometimes in our lives, when we sense that God is calling us to do something difficult, aren't we tempted to say, hang on, aren't we tempted to protest? Y'all have heard me say in the time I've been with you, sometimes God gets bored and he messes with me. And I think sometimes we all feel like that, that God sometimes sees me being a little bit too comfortable. And I'm gonna mess with Bill. Well, God knew how much Abraham loved Isaac. It wasn't anything that God didn't know. And we tend to think this can't be God's will. Doesn't God know how much that's gonna hurt? But the passage shows that God does know. God does know how much what he has told Abraham to do will hurt. And you know how we know that? Because God does not make mistakes. In the 20th verse of chapter 20, it tells us that God tests us to confirm our faith and to prove our commitment. And then I found a sentence that bears that out, that explains it so well. Hear these words. Satan tempts us to bring out the very worst in us. God tests us to bring out the best in us. So God tested Abraham. And how does Abraham respond? Well, the scripture says, early the next morning, Abraham got up and he saddled the donkey. Early in the morning. If I had to do something I didn't want to, I really think I would have slept until 9 o'clock. I don't think I would have gotten up early and gotten right to it. And that's the way we are. If we've got something to do we don't want to do, how many of you all have ever procrastinated and come up with good excuses not to do it? But that's not what Abraham did. The sun came up and so did Abraham. And he thought, this is what God has told me to do. I've got to do it. So Abraham shows how faithful he is, and he is so obedient. So he got up and he saddled his donkey. Well, we've been in those situations where our world, just like Abraham's now, has totally been turned upside down. Remember a couple of weeks ago when we talked about life isn't always a rose garden? Sometimes we hit the stones. Well, Abraham and Sarah's world just got turned upside down. People's marriages fall apart. Jobs get lost. Folks that are dear to us die. The security that we thought we had goes away for some reason. And everything about our lives becomes shattered, and I think that it's perfectly normal when those things happen for us to shout with anguish, it's just not fair. I had plans. I had plans to grow old with my spouse. I had plans to retire from the company that I started with 25 years ago. I had plans to live into my old age healthy and vital. And now, look what has happened